Hi, my name is Ferdinand Roaquin, and I'm currently the Division Chief of the Human Resource Management Department, Subic Bay Metropolitan Authority. I am a resident of Walang Subic Bay, and currently, of course, as the Division Chief of the Human Resource Management Department, we are involved in the processing of appointments of our personnel. I was also among the early volunteers of the Subic Bay Metropolitan Authority. In fact, I was fresh out of college way back in 1993 when I joined in SBMA. I grew up here, so I know exactly what was going on. And during my early years, I saw Walang Subic Bay as one of the most cosmopolitan, I think one of the most cosmopolitan city in the Philippines, because it hosted one of the largest U.S. naval base. So you can imagine that there are lots of establishments, especially along Magsaysay Drive. And at the same time, of course, you get the latest from the United States. After the lights went out, when the Americans left way back in 1992, Walang Subic Bay became a ghost town. Unfortunately, a lot of people lost their jobs, including my brother. And at that time, I was in college. I was taking up political science at the University of Santo Tomas. And I was supposed to take up law, like most of my classmates. In fact, some of them, at least I know one of them is already a judge, and the other one is already a an associate justice. But then again, of course, if you are a political science graduate, you tend to be idealistic. And I was looking for an agency I can work with, no? That I find that I can make a difference. And I've heard about the Subic Bay Metropolitan Authority. I've heard about the volunteers. And I got this, and I got myself thinking, since I came from Walang Subic Bay, why not be among the volunteers? Why not join in rebuilding what used to be a bustling city, which of course way back then became a virtual ghost town. So I joined in SBME as a volunteer. This in spite of the fact that I was offered work, you know, by my scholarship benefactor, Jaka. And the very first thing I saw when I came here was there were a lot of people actually. No? Not only from this area, but in fact even from other areas. No? Some of which were of course as young as I am. Some of course were older, no? Because the early volunteers way back then are really the former workers of the U.S. Naval Base, who, after the Americans left, actually secured the area, okay, in hope that they can make something out of what used to be, of course, the biggest military facility in the world. And in those early years, everyone was actually busy. We're busy in promoting the former naval base into a Freeport zone. And to be honest, if you look at it, this was actually the very first Freeport zone in the Philippines. It was actually, in a way, some sort of an experiment. Even the national government has no really concrete plans of how to develop this area. So with the leadership of then-Mayor Richard Gordon, who was the first chairman of the Subic Bay Metropolitan Authority, little by little, Subic Bay became what it is right now. In fact, I think the very first investor here was a hotel, Subic International Hotel, if I'm not mistaken. And way back then, I was with the Public Affairs Office. My work then entails that I disseminate information to the public, especially to the media, of what's going on. And my original plan was only to volunteer for 6 months and then afterwards go back to Manila and pursue law. But because of what I saw in way back then, the happenings, the development, you know, it makes you rethink your plans in life, because every time that we actually open up a vacancy here, I mean a job vacancy, you can see a long line of people applying for jobs. And that kind of like make you feel really good inside, because, you know, you're doing something for the community. And little by little, of course, you see other investors coming in. We used to have a Reebok factory here that employs a lot of people. So we used to manufacture Reebok. We used to have Acer, which is one of the biggest computer manufacturers in the world, which is based in Taiwan, which employed, I think, during their heyday, as much as 5,000 workers. And then you also have a lot of activities inside the Freeport. In fact, one time, I still remember there was an article that came out in the papers. Those people were supposed to go to Baguio during the summer, half of which actually went to Freeport. And I know that for a fact because being connected with the public affairs office, I used to entertain the media before. And I used to take them to the beaches. I used to take them around the Freeport zone, tell them stories about what's going on. And one time, one summer, I remember, I took one media outfit in one of the beaches here. And virtually, you cannot find a place in the sand anymore because literally, there were lots of people. And I said to myself, you know, this is the future of the Freeport. This is the future of SBMA. And of course, other events which are very significant that happened in the Freeport was, of course, the hosting of APEC. And it was very significant because I think it was the very first time that the Philippines hosted the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation here in the Freeport, participated by several leaders of world leaders, of course, including then President Bill Clinton of the United States of America. And we were preparing for that actually 2 or 3 weeks before, you know, our office. And I still remember, I think it was the night or two nights before, if I'm not mistaken, I even went up to the area where they're going to have, where they're going to hold the meeting. We were setting up computers for actually for enough for the media, and at the same time we were actually directing them where to go, and we almost had barely any sleep because of that preparation, but it went well. During the actual meeting itself, I was interviewed by a media from Indonesia. I've forgotten already the media outfit. One of the questions that was asked of me was, how do I find people who are against the hosting of the Philippines of APEC? Because there were several demonstrators actually on their way to the Freeport. And knowing that Indonesia way back then was under a strongman rule, I just simply said that we are a democracy. They're entitled to their own opinion. But we're also entitled, of course, to host the APEC as successful as it should be. I still remember when we had the airport reconstructed, the runway that is, so that we can accommodate the larger airplanes of then FedEx. Because as you all know, Subic Bay way back then was chosen as a Federal Express hub in the Asia-Pacific region before, of course, they eventually transferred to China. And every night, every evening, you can find a lot of wide-bodied aircrafts landing in our airport. So we're actually a very good and very functioning airport way back then. But prior to that, of course, we were preparing it. And then President Ramos, I still remember, was coming from the United States on board a newly acquired 747, I think 600 or 700 series, and he wanted to land it in Subic, okay, just to test how good the airport was. And the night before that happened, there were a lot of presidential security guard securing the tarmac. I think they even placed several logs, you know, going inside the tarmac so that, you know, to prevent any untoward incident. And I was like doing my usual rounds. It was evening, I believe, around 10 p.m. So I told the driver, Ed Santiago, who happens to be also one of our photographers way back then, I want to inspect the tarmac. Little did we know, when we were about to approach the tarmac, there was a log there the lug was actually painted black, so you can actually see it. So we ran over the lug. My head took a hit on the windshield. I was bleeding, but I was conscious. And I told Ed, bring me to the hospital because I might be suffering from some internal hemorrhage. But I was very much awake at that time. So they first initially took me to the airport dispensary. Then afterwards, admitted me to General Hospital, along with General Hospital, because we don't have James Gordon Memorial Hospital way back then. And the doctor gave me a clean bill of health, told me that it was just, a flesh wound because I was bleeding. But they didn't stitch my head. They just simply gave me a gauze and told me to take a rest. So the following day, our head, Antonio Sardegna, was asking me how was I feeling. I said, that's okay, but I would really like to go back to work. And he told me, you don't have to, just take a rest and we will take it from here. So these are one of those, what you call, memorable incident that happened in my life. From administration of Chairman Gordon up to the present, all I can say is that the Subic Bay Metropolitan Authorities actually have done a lot of things for this country. So the Freeport Zone, I believe, Subic Bay Metropolitan Authority being the administrator of the Subic Bay Freeport Zone, has become really to what then President Bill Clinton said, an economic resource for the country. A lot of people have joined SBMA, so as old people, with the combination of these two types of people, including of course the leadership of then Chairman Gordon, we have created something out of nothing. Okay. Of course, a lot of people would say, no, it's not really nothing. You have all of these assets all around you. Yeah, sure. But how were you able to use those assets in order for you to generate all of these opportunities? That is the biggest question. Okay. Remember, just like what I said early on, that this is the very first Freeport in the country. It was an experiment. Okay. Nobody knows how to run a Freeport. Okay. Not even a national government. Okay. The national government doesn't have, prior to that, any idea of how to transform this former naval base into what it is right now. In fact, way back then, I still remember, there's this movement to create what you call an autonomous region of Greater Olongapo, Argo. And I believe for the years to come, we do expect more opportunities here. And we hope that we can contribute to the problem of the national government in easing up what you call the traffic in Metro Manila. Okay, one of the biggest problem right now is of course the traffic in Metro Manila because the concentration of business is in Metro Manila, and yet you have places like Clark, places like Subic, places like Batangas, places like Cagayan. If we can decentralize. I don't know whether it's a political statement, but I don't want to make a political statement. If we can decentralize Imperial Manila, possibly this country can move better, okay? Because we all know that according to a one JICA study, billions of pesos were actually lost because of the traffic alone in Metro Manila. Why not, why not make Subic as an alternative port? Why not make Batangas as an alternative port, right? So that you can decongest Metro Manila. Now, what is my message? What is the message behind the Subic Bay Metropolitan Authority? What is the message behind young people like me volunteering way back then? The message is very clear. There's still hope for this country. Okay. Now, I know it's a little bit baduy. Now, if I would say that it's not a waste of time to be idealistic. It's just that you really have to find the right vehicle for you. You don't have to go to the mountains in order for you to change society. You don't have to do anything drastic. You can actually change society, you can change the way that you live little by little. If you join the government service like I did, you'll find a certain fulfillment. Okay. And I believe I've found it here in the Subic Bay Metropolitan Authority. So we have to start believing again. And that's my message.